What do you think about playing the MS game? I noticed you don't have any Birkins or Kellys on your wish list. Yeah. How much time do you have? Hello everyone and welcome back to my channel, to my little corner of the internet here where we talk about luxury designer handbags. So today is the second part of my Bag Talk Monday series, and it's still a pretty new series, and I'm hoping that it will establish itself over the next couple of weeks, couple of months. So whenever anyone basically has a question for me, please just let me know in the comment section down below and I will respond to it the next Bag Talk Monday. On the next Bag Talk Monday, yeah. Okay, so today's first question is from Vera W. What do you think about playing the MS game? I noticed you don't have any Birkins or Kellys on your wish list. Yeah. How much time do you have? No, I mean, all jokes aside, what do I think about playing the MS game? I think if we look at it from a marketing kind of standpoint, MS, the brand, has done an amazing job. I mean, they've created the most coveted handbags in the world. Everybody on this planet wants to have an MS Birkin and an MS Kelly in their collection at some point. And it works, you know. People are trying for years and years and years to get their hands on a store fresh Birkin if they don't want to go down the pre-loved market. So their strategy has been probably the most successful that we've seen in the luxury industry. So I can kind of understand it from the brand's perspective, from the customer's perspective. I can only imagine how annoying it has been for a lot of people who've been trying for a long, long time. I myself have not tried to get one yet, simply because, yes, as you have noticed properly, there are no Birkins or Kellys on my wish list right now. And that is simply the case because I, for myself, have decided that I want to tick off all the other bags on my wish list first before I'm gonna focus on getting MS bags. I don't know why that is. I just always feel like, of course, you need to have something that you can basically reach for. You know, I don't know, it's the same with my Chanel Jumbo. I could have gotten it 1,000 times and I still haven't added it to my collection, simply because I think you need to have that holy grail bag, that bag that you are still, you know, really lusting after. So yeah, I definitely know what kind of Birkin and what kind of Kelly I do want to have in my collection in the future at some point. However, yeah, I haven't really, you know, been thinking about, am I going to play the MS game or am I just gonna go down the pre-loved route, you know, and get exactly what I want. Because I have a very specific idea of the bags that I actually do want to have, and I would not accept another bag. So the whole playing the game and, you know, befriending NSA and buying a lot of other goods from MS, which I personally do not like. I think a lot of their fashion, a lot of their shoes, they are just not, I don't know, they're not my aesthetic. So for me, it's always been clear that either I'm gonna try my luck in Paris, where you don't need a purchase history and you're just gonna go there and basically see if the SA likes you or if she doesn't. And then see if they have something in stock. They obviously always have something in stock, but you know, how often have we heard like, no, sorry, we don't have anything today. So yeah, I think I would definitely not buy a lot of goods to get a purchase history, to then maybe get onto the waiting list, to get the specific Birkin and the specific color and the specific hardware that you want at some point. So I'm not gonna do that for sure. but I would definitely think about maybe, you know, flying to Paris, just try my luck there. I mean, we all know that it can happen in the flagship store, that you could actually get a bag without, you know, having ever purchased anything from MS, the brand, the store directly. So I do have an MS Birkin and an MS Kelly on my wish list, but it's kind of like an invisible area of my wish list. I do appreciate their bags. I have sold Birkins and Kellys in the past because I'm a reseller as well, as my little, you know, hobby. But yeah, it's not in my near future to get one within this year or within the next year, I think. But who knows? I mean, you never know, right? Also, just to throw it in there, I know exactly what colors I want and what sizes basically and what hardware. So I could definitely see myself, you know, walking down the path of the pre-loved market in order to get the MS bag of my dream. Simply because I do know my, I want a Kelly 32 in black box calf leather with gold hardware from my birth year. I mean, obviously that one has to be vintage. but also in terms of the Birkin that I want, I know that I want Togo leather at some point. I don't want the Epson leather. I don't want any of the other leathers. I want Togo leather simply because it's the most durable one, I think, and the most popular one, if you ever would think about reselling your bag. And I either want to have a black one, a raisin one, or an anemone one. And all of these bags should have gold hardware. So because I have so many must-haves basically on my wish list, I don't think I would ever be as lucky of like in terms of finding that bag in the boutique. Okay, so next question is from Angelina Cooper. Hey there again. what do you think of the Chanel 19? Yeah, so I think my story with the Chanel 19 is pretty similar to my first reaction to the Chanel Gabrielle bag. My first reaction was basically when the Gabrielle was brought out by Karl Lagerfeld, I was thinking, what the hell is that? I thought it's an ugly bag, and I thought I couldn't really see the appeal of it, and I could not see any basically positive points when it came to the Chanel Gabrielle bag. I didn't like it. I know for sure that I didn't like the Gabrielle, and now I love it. So my first reaction to the Chanel 19 was, that looks kind of like a bin bag. The black leather looks really shiny, and it just, the way the bag folds, I mean, the bag is new basically when you get it and already looks completely slouchy and sunken in. And I really thought, like, I know it's this cushion style that's in at the moment, but for me it just, yeah, I didn't really particularly like it when I saw it for the first time. I think right now I'm still at a stage where I don't want to add one to my collection. I do not know if the 19 bag will actually establish itself as a classic bag. I mean, we can probably only see that in 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 years. In terms of if it's actually gonna enter the classic range of Chanel handbags. Yeah, but like I said, like, who knows what's gonna happen in my brain. So I hated the Chanel Gabrielle bag when it came out, and now I love it. I mean, I have my Chanel Gabrielle in the medium size as well as Chanel Gabrielle backpack. So, you know. Okay, so the next question is from Lisa Sophie. Hey lovely, I'm looking to buy a Louis Vuitton Alma bag, but I'm not sure which size I should pick, BB or PM. Which one do you think is the better choice and why, and how do they differ in terms of handle length and what fits inside? Yeah, okay, so maybe to show you a little bit of eye candy in this Bag Talk Mondays as well, I do have this beautiful Louis Vuitton Alma bag, and this is the PM size, which is the medium size of the current available sizes, and this is also the original size that was made for Coco Chanel. I'm going to put up a picture of the BB size up here, and just so that you can compare both sizes, so yeah, you can see the difference. I would say in comparison to this one, the BB size is about this height. So we have like, yeah, and maybe that helps your imagination. But yeah, it's a pretty big size difference, a pretty significant size difference when it comes to those two bags. And both have their advantages and disadvantages. So if you open this bag up, it is quite roomy. Let me show you. So there is tons and tons of space in there. I like to carry like a full-size wallet, an umbrella, a brush, like a full-size brush. my makeup, you could even fit a tablet in here. Phones, keys, my gimbal even fits in here. Like my little hand tripod that I use to film the shopping vlogs for you guys. So yeah, this bag is pretty spacious. So of course, if you don't need that much space, the BB is a good choice. It's a very pretty bag. In terms of proportions, you've asked if they differ in terms of handle lengths. No, they do not. So that's a really important fact actually of how I made my decision, because I was for a while actually thinking of, you know, do I get the BB size, do I get the PM size, and the handles of both bags are exactly the same. So because the BB size is a lot smaller, I feel like the handles sometimes look overwhelming. They are pretty big, so you have to imagine the other bag is basically the it ends here, and it has the same handle. So if you let the handles down and you actually carry the bag with the shoulder strap, you basically only see handles, if that makes sense. Handle length is exactly the same, and the other bag is a lot smaller. So proportion wise, I always thought, like, with the beautiful untreated vachetta leather parts, that the PM size is the nicest. But I mean, this is all very personal, of course, personal preference. And yeah, I would advise just go into the shop and look at both bags, compare them, see how they look like on your body frame, see what you can fit in actually, and then make a decision. Okay, so next question is from Eliza Ward. Can I go into any Dior boutique and get my vintage bag fixed without a purchase history? And I know that somebody has already responded to you, somebody who actually asked me the question in the first place, but I thought, you know, for anybody else who's interested in this topic out there, that they might profit from me answering this again. You do not need a purchase history, so I know for myself, I mean, I did have an SA luckily, because I've been, you know, purchasing other items from Dior in the past. For example, my Mini Lady Dior was purchased directly from the boutique. I purchased a lot of, like, Dior jewelry in the past, like custom jewelry, and I've resold all of these pieces, so unfortunately I don't have anything to show you anymore. So I did have a purchase history, however my SA told me for sure, because one of my friends has done it as well, that you do not need one. Ari 1202A has called in at Dior as well and asked, and yeah, we got the confirmation now that you still don't need a purchase history in 2020. So of course rules and regulations can change, but so far so good. So you don't need anything. You don't need the proof of purchase. They authenticate the bag themselves, obviously, when it's sent to Paris. And yeah, you can basically just buy a beautiful bag on the pre-loved market, and we all do know that Dior bags are a lot more affordable on the pre-loved market, and you can find really good deals, and you can find really beautiful rare vintage pieces as well, or even exotics that are a lot cheaper. I mean, my Lady Dior bag retailed for $11,800 US, and I got it for a fraction of that. So yeah, I can only advise to go towards the pre-loved route and go and focus on the resale market and find a beautiful bag and bring it into Dior, and you know, they're gonna make it pretty. They're gonna doll it up. It's a fraction of the price, the fee that you have to pay in comparison to the retail price. So yeah, I hope that helps. Yeah, okay guys, so that was everything for today's video. I hope that you did enjoy it. If you like this video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe. Join our little handbag obsessed family here, and yeah, that would be really nice. I hope you have a wonderful day, and I see you guys soon. Bye!